session. So today we will be studying, like, seeing some more interview questions that can be asked. And today we will be discussing mainly the questions, interview questions related to SVM and KNL. Okay, so let's start. Alright, so before moving forward, there was one question that was asked by Gayatri. Okay, so you asked that why logistic regression, is a linear model. Okay, so so you are asking this question that why linear regression is a linear model. So, like, I will try to explain it, okay, more to you, what happens, that why it's a linear model. Okay, so suppose these are my points, these are non-diabetics, you know, and these people are diabetic, you know, and my logistic regression function goes like this, you know. Now what happens, how am I classifying what is the thing that I use for classification, you know? The thing that I use for classification is the threshold. Okay, so I can define any threshold, you know, as per my requirement. I can choose any threshold. Suppose I choose threshold equal to 0.5, you know. So what will I do? Threshold equal to 0.5, you know, I will draw a line, you know. So this line, you know, this line, you know, will be the separating line, you know. Can you tell me in this what are the number of features we have talking about this non-diabetic and diabetic? What are the number of features we are having? And this is the sugar level, okay, and this is 0 or 1. Yeah, what do you think, what are the number of classes we have? Please tell, first tell, what are the number of features we have in this? Okay, so the number of features in this example is 1. Okay, only sugar level we have. Based on sugar level, I'm making a prediction. So, okay. So what I have done, I have used the classes, you know, these classes as on the y-axis, you know. If I draw them on the x-axis, it will be like this, you know, all the sugar levels will be like this. And what will logistic regression do? It will define a point over here, you know. It will define a point over here, and it will say, okay, if you are less than this point, you know, it will find the threshold. Okay, like, what will happen, that there will be a sugar level, you know, there will be a sugar level for which the sigmoid output is 0.5, you know, there will be a sugar level. So that sugar level, you know, that sugar level will be used as a threshold, you know. So, like, that is the reason. Don't think that the boundary is like the sigmoid is having. Like, by using sigmoid, okay, we just find a threshold, okay. Using sigmoid, we just find a threshold, and based on that threshold, we do the, we separate the classes, you know. So that threshold, know, that threshold is always a linear line. That threshold, you know, like if we talk in case of like this was 1D, you know, this was one dimensional, only one dimension was there. So here I had a single point. You know? So if we have multiple features, you know, if we have multiple features, then what will happen? In 1D, there was one point, you know, there was a single point using which I was doing, okay, I was differentiating them on the classes. When I have two classes, okay, I will have a straight line, okay. So like the thing, the defining this logistic regression in this 3D is like pretty difficult. But you just remember this, that basically we do the prediction based on the threshold only, you know? And that threshold, okay, that threshold, okay, is basically linear, you know, that is not non-linear. So that is why, like, you know, logistic regression is a linear model, okay. Now the second question that we were discussing yesterday, that how does the value of c affect, you know, the sigmoid curve, you know? So I guess you would have understood how m will affect the sigmoid, you know? You know, I guess you will understand, but let me try to explain you. Suppose this is one sigmoid curve, you know, this is my x-axis, this is my y-axis, and this is another sigmoid curve, the same sigmoid curve, okay, I have moved forward in some direction, you know? Okay, so first is this, second is this. So can you tell me okay, so the equation, okay, what will be the equation of the sigmoid? You know, sigmoid will be 1 upon 1 plus e raised to the power minus mx plus c. You know? So here, what will happen, that c will be more. You know? C will be more. While here, c will be less. Okay, if c is more, then my curve, okay, will move in the backward direction, like it will move in the backward direction. If c is less, you know, it will move in this forward direction. Okay, so okay, that's how the value of c will be affected. Okay, so let's discuss some questions on SVM. Okay. So, like the first question is, like, is SVM a supervised learning algorithm? Is SVM a supervised learning algorithm? It's not showing. Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Just give me 1 second. This was my question, like, is SVM a supervised learning algorithm or it's unsupervised? Please tell. Let me This is a simple question. What do you think? Okay, so this is also a supervised learning algorithm, you know, because we give the target labels also, you know, in the input. So like this was my first question, and second question is that like these are my different points, okay, and I draw this margin, okay. I draw this margin and then I draw a separating line, you know, this is my separating line. Now what is this called, these points, what are these called which lie on the boundary? Points which lie on the boundary, what are they called? Yeah, come on, like we have already discussed this. What are these
support points? Vectors.
Yeah, correct. They're known as support vectors. Yeah, the points which are lying on the boundary. Okay, so this is okay, this is the separating line. And what is this called? This distance between these boundaries. Okay, so this is known as the margin. This is known as the margin. So okay, so these are the things that are there in support vector machines. Now like what is my aim in SVM, like what is my goal in SVM? Like any, please tell, what is my goal in like aim in SVM? Okay, so my goal in SVM is to find, okay, the support vectors, you know, support vectors, you know, with maximum margin distance, you know? First thing is the margin should be as maximum as possible, you know, and second should be that all the classes, you know, all the points, all the points belonging to same class, you know, should lie on the other part of the other part of the margin, you know? So like this is the margin that I have over here. So what do I want, you know? This margin, you know, this margin should like on this side only, like suppose we are saying this zero, you know, these points as positive points, on one side only positive points should lie, you know, but on the other side, you know, all the negative points should lie. So you can see that here we have the negative points, here we have the positive point, you know, and same is the case with this margin also, you know, same is the case with this also, So here also what will happen that on this side, on this side all the points are positive, and on this side all the points are negative. Okay, so that is the thing. Give me just 1 second, I'll tell you one thing. Okay. All right. So sorry, we like these will be known as the boundary. Boundary. This is known as the boundary. These are the support vectors, and we'll create a boundary, So two constraint should be followed over here. First, that the margin should be as maximum as possible, and the boundary, the boundary that I have, should be able to differentiate the classes that I have. Okay, so these are the two constraints that should be followed, in my SVM. So the third question comes that can we use gradient descent in SVM? Can we use gradient descent in SVM? Like any like any guesses, like can we use or can we not use? Okay, so like we haven't seen any of the mathematics of the support vector machines, all the derivations and all. So like I will tell you like in simple words what happened, that we cannot use gradient descent in SVM. And the question is that why cannot we use? Because like we have another constraint also over here, we have another constraint also. Like one thing is that we need to find the separating separating line. One goal is this, to get the separating line. Another goal is to maximize this margin, to maximize this margin. But the gradient descent is a will work for unconstrained problems. Like I was using gradient descent in linear regression, so what was my goal in linear regression? To only minimize the cost, this was my only goal in linear regression, only to minimize the cost. So this thing can be done by gradient descent. I don't have any limitations or constraints over here. But in SVM, what happens that there are two things. One is that that's correct. We need to find a line, which separates these two points. So first thing is this. Another thing is that this margin, this margin should be as large as possible. So that is why this is because of the second constraint we are not able to use gradient descent in SVM. So like this was another question. Let's see some other question. So question is can SVM work for more than two classes? Can SVM work for more than two classes? Yeah, any guess? Like, can we use SVM to differentiate like more than two classes? Like, suppose my points are like this. No? So, can I do like this using the SVM? No? This kind of boundary, can I may draw this boundary? Okay, so answer is yes. We can use one versus all method. So we discussed this method last time also, in case of logistic regression. So can anyone of you explain what we do in one versus all method? Please tell, last time only we had discussed. Okay, so like the same thing we will be doing, that we will train multiple SVM, SVM models. First model will be trained for class 1, only for class 1, Second will be for class 2, and third will be for class 3, And in the end, the results of all the SVMs will be conversed, and then we will get the final answer, But here what will happen, that I will not get like answers. I will get these boundaries, I will get these different boundaries. So suppose what will happen, that first SVM will work for only this crosses and minus. Suppose SVM worked for this, So for this, I got this separating line, for this cross and minus one, then my SVM will work for this these crosses, these crosses and rest other like first would be this, first we'll take this class, this class versus all. So then red line will be made. Then what will happen, that then it will take the negative, and all. So what will it do? It will create another separating line, which will differentiate this negative also and all these points. Then what will happen, it will take into account this rounded points and these cross and minus points, So what will it do? It will create another line, So like, how will we interpret, these boundaries that I have got, these boundaries, So this boundary will belong to this negative one, and this boundary will belong to this. So basically, we can use SVM for more than two classes. Although here I think this is becoming a little bit complex, So like, you don't need to worry much about this. I'm just telling you that how it will form the boundary, So first will be these crosses and rest points. Then it will be these minus and other points. And it will be these these round and other points. So I will be getting these three. Then after this, how will I do? Okay, so I'm not sure about that, how after this they will do the classification. That I need to look. Okay, all right, so like, we'll move forward. Okay, but just remember that we can use SVM for more than two classes. Okay, so there is one more thing that is known as hard margin, and soft margin. So what happens that suppose points are like this, points are like this, cross I have, now what will be my separating like what will be my boundaries will be this, you know, because like this is the boundary number one, this is the boundary number two, you know, and between these two boundaries, you know, I will have my separating line, you know. So what has happened that every boundary that I have taken, you know, is what it is doing, it is strictly separating the, you know, these we can consider these as positive classes and these as negative classes, you know? It is strictly differentiating, you know? So these kind of like SVMs where each boundary is strictly separating the positive points and negative points correctly, you know, so those SVMs, you know, are known as SVMs with hard margin, you know? SVMs with hard margin. But what happens that we can ignore, you know, we can ignore these points, you know, we can ignore these points and we can create another, you know, we can consider them as outliers also, you know. So what will happen that the same I will try to draw. So what will I do in soft margin? I will allow some predictions to be wrong, you know? In soft margin I will allow some predictions to be wrong. So here you can see if we use this boundary, then what will happen that this point is wrongly classified, you know, and if I use this boundary, this point is wrongly classified. So here what am I doing and what will be the separating line? It will be in the middle. It will be in the middle. So this will be my separating line. So in soft margin SVM, what we do, we allow some points to be on the other side of the boundary. That means I allow some error to be introduced, you know. Now like what happens, this SVMs with hard margin leads to overfitting, you know, this leads to overfitting. And if we use like what will happen if large number of points come over here, then what will happen? Will that lead to underfitting or overfitting? If large number of points are lying on this side, okay, so this will lead to underfitting, you know. See like what will happen if I increase, just give me, I'll try to explain it in much better way, you know. See this is earlier I was using the support vectors, I was using them as support vectors, you know. Now what will I do? I'll use them as support vectors, you know, these points as support vectors, and these points will lie over here, you know? So my separating line, you know, my separating line is able to classify all the points correctly, because over here, you know, I have all the zeros, and over here I have like on this side I have all the x's, you know, all the x, but this decision boundary is like finally, so I will use this only, you know, finally, so I will use this only, but it can also happen that this round, you know, this rounded point can come here also. You know, then what will happen? That this point will be misclassified because this boundary says that here every point should be x, but it is a zero. You know, so this point will be misclassified. So if you know large number of points are misclassified, you know, so that will lead to underfitting. You know, so that is why we need to take a balance. You know, we generally use soft margin in real life. You know, but the thing is that we need to control the error also. You know, control the error in such a way that the model is able to generalize well. What is the meaning of this? Model is able to generalize well. What is the meaning of this statement? Okay, so the meaning of this statement is that in overfitting, what happens? That test accuracy will be high. You know, in overfitting, test accuracy will be high, but train accuracy will be low. You know, and if a model is able to generalize well, you know, then test accuracy is high and train is also high. You know, but there will be a difference. Train accuracy is high. Here also train accuracy high. Like here, train accuracy will be like 99%, but over here train accuracy will be little bit less, like 93%, but test accuracy will be good over here. Okay, if a model is able to generalize well, like it would be 90%, but here it would be 70%. You know, so I will be choosing this model. You know, I will choose this model because the model is doing well, you know, on the unseen data. You know, this test, you know, test data that I have, this is the unseen data because the model has been trained on this trained data. You know, this model, this data though my model has seen, but this data my model has not seen, then also it is able to perform well on that. You know, so I will try to choose that model. You know, so like that is the way, you know, we try to use the soft margin. You know, and if we use the hard margin, okay, so if there are outliers in my data, then my SVM will not perform well. Okay, because in real life, like outliers are very common. Okay, so what happens that in sklearn, you know, we have seen this sklearn library, you know, where we can use logistic regression, linear regression, you know, linear regression and SVC, you know, the support vector machines, we were like calling them there. You know, we were calling this library support vector classifier. You know, so this is the different name they are using. So in SVC, you know, we saw a parameter that was kernel equal to poly. You know, so different kernels we had seen earlier, you know, but like there are other parameters also, you know. So one of them is C. Okay, so C defines the hardness, you know, hardness or softness of the margin. You know, C defines the hardness or the softness of the margin. Now what will happen that if C is very high, if C value is very high, okay, then what will happen that the SVM will have hard margin. Okay, SVM will have hard margin. If C equal to like zero, you know, this will lead to soft margin. You know, so you know, so what does this C tells? C tells that how much how much you want to avoid misclassification in the training data. How much misclassification you want to avoid? Suppose I want that the accuracy of my model in the train data should be very high. Then what will I do? That means I want the error to be minimum. So then what will I do? I will increase my C. If I allow some error, it will not be zero, but it will be less. Now suppose C equal to 500. These are two models, C equal to 1000 and C equal to 500. So what will happen that on the test, it will have accuracy of 99%, but this will have accuracy of maybe 95%. So I told you, if the accuracy, accuracy in my like training data goes very high, then it will lead to which condition? If the accuracy goes very high in my training data, then it will lead to which condition? Overfitting or underfitting? Come on, guys, like these are very simple questions. No, it will lead to overfitting. No, if the accuracy is very high in my training data. Accuracy of my model is very high on my training data, then this will lead to overfitting. Okay. And if the accuracy is very less, then it will lead to underfitting. So my goal is to avoid overfitting and underfitting. And I need to get a generalized model, which is able to perform well in test data set also and train data set also. Okay. Okay. So let's see another question. Okay. Is where has it gone? Is normalization required in SVMs? Is normalization required in SVM? Okay. So the answer is that yes. No? Yes, normalization is required in SVM. No? And that's very important. No? So the thing is like if we don't use normalization, then what will it do? It will give more importance to a particular feature. It will do classification. It will do classification based on the feature which is having the large scale, which is having the values in like larger range. Suppose we have age 1 to 100 and we have salary. So 100k to 500k, like any range. So this value is very high. So what will happen that all the classification will be done based on the salary only. So this will be ignored. So that's why it is important that we need to normalize the data. Okay. So this is also one of the questions that can be asked, whether normalization is required or not required. Okay. So let's see another question. Okay. What does kernels do to the what does kernel do? This is a simple question. Can anyone of you tell what does kernels do? What does kernel function do? So, like kernel function, what kernel function does? It takes my data to higher dimension. It takes my data to higher dimension. So, like, will it take data to higher dimension like every time? If my data is non-linear, then only it will take the data to higher dimension, so that my data becomes linear now. It will take my data to higher dimension. It will convert the non-linear data into linear data. Then it will use hyperplane to separate various classes. Okay. So I guess like I have explained you how the data we take to higher dimensions. We add a new dimension that is defined by the kernel. So kernel helps in like taking the data to higher dimensions so that it becomes linearly separable. Okay. And what are the different types of kernels that we have? Okay, so three kernels we have seen: linear kernel, polynomial kernel, and radial basis function. These are the three kernels that I have. So what happens over here that my points are like this. So in linear it will create a straight line, but in polynomial, it will create the boundary like this. Like the thing is that this may seem confusing. I'm saying that linear like support vector machines is a linear model, but what will happen that these kernels they will take data to higher dimensions in like different way. Although the separating hyperplane will be linear. Okay. And radial basis function, what we have, they form a clusters. All different type of data form the clusters. Okay. So these are some of the kernels that we have. Okay, let's see another question. So other question is what is gamma? So one hyperparameter we have seen that is C. This C we have seen. So and another hyperparameter is gamma. So what does this gamma do? That it defines the influence of the single training example for final decision boundary. No. So what will happen that see if gamma is high, no? So what will happen that every point will be given more importance, no? See, like in general, what should we do? No, less importance should be given to the outliers in my data, no? To the outliers in my data, less importance should be given, and the most important should be given to these support vectors that I have, no? I should give them more importance, no? So what will happen that suppose this is my separating line, no? This is my separating line. Now what will happen that if, no, gamma value is high, then every point will have more weight, you know. Then what will happen that my model will overfit. Every point is given equal weight, so my model will overfit, no? Okay, so gamma is high, then model will overfit. Okay, and same goes like if gamma is very low, then model, if it is very low, then model will underfit. Okay, so like these were the two things, okay, gamma and the C parameter that we saw earlier. Okay, so now we will see like some of the questions related to KNN. Okay, so let's see. So the first question is, can we use KNN for more than two classes? Yeah, what do you think? Can we use KNN for more than two classes? For differentiating between more than two classes, is it possible in KNN? Okay, so that's completely possible, and same thing we will be using, one versus all method, you know. So if we have three classes, then for like this will train for class one, this model will train for class two, this will train for class three, you know, and whichever will have the maximum number of votes, you know, that will win. Okay, so like that's pretty straightforward. Like all the algorithms, you know, that can do binary classification, those algorithm can be used for doing multi-class classification also. Okay, so the next question is that can we use KNN for regression? So the answer is this, yes, we can use KNN for regression. Okay, so how can we do that? See, what will happen that I have a point, so I have different points. So if k equal to 5 I am taking, so what will it do? Like in classification, what it did, it tried to calculate the number of classes, nearest 5 classes it finds. So whichever get the most number of votes, this point will belong to that class only. So here we have, this has got 3 and this has got 2. So new point will belong to this class. But now what will happen in regression? ना दिस पॉइंट ना फॉर दिस पॉइंट द वैल्यू है ना द वैल्यू विल बी द एवरेज ऑफ ऑल दीज वैल्यूज ऑल दीज फाइव वैल्यूज है ना नाउ वी विल टेक द एवरेज है ना इन क्लासिफिकेशन वी वर डूइंग वोटिंग ओके बट इन रिग्रेशन वी विल टेक द एवरेज ऑफ द के नियरेस्ट पॉइंट ओके सो बाय डूइंग दिस वी कैन यूज के एन एन फॉर रिग्रेशन है ना And I guess you would be knowing you know, what we do in regression. You know, we try to find a like continuous output. You know? So that thing can be done using KNN also. And that and SVMs also can be used. You know, SVMs can also be used for regression. You know? But how they are used, that becomes a little bit complicated topic. So like we'll not go into that, you know, but just remember that SVM also we can use for regression, you know. So we call them as like SVR, okay, support vector regressor. You know? We call them this. Okay. So let's see some more question. What happens? If we increase the value of k in KNN, what happens if we increase the value of k? If k is 1, what does it leads to? Overfit or underfit? Please tell if k is low, then to which condition it leads? Underfit or overfit? Okay, so if k is low and k is equal to 1, then it will lead to overfit condition. You know? So in overfit condition, what happens? We have low bias. You know? We have low bias and high variance. Okay, so these are the two things that happen. If k is low, if k is very high, you know, then it leads to underfit, you know, it will lead to underfit, you know. So basically what we take the value of k generally under root square root of n. N is the number of samples. So generally we take the value of k to be under root of n. So but like how can I choose the value of n? You know, what will I do? I will see like I will train, you know. I will take different values of k, you know, I will take different values of k, then I will plot the accuracy using this k, you know, using this k, I will train, you know, I will do the predictions for my test data, you know. So what will happen? So if k equal to 1, you know, then accuracy is suppose 70%, you know. If k equal to 5, then accuracy will be 80%, you know. If k equal to 8, then accuracy will be 90%, you know. If k equal to 20, you know, so then okay. So it happens like this, you know. If we will increase the value of k, you know, then like this is my accuracy, you know, accuracy in testing data. Okay, if I increase the value of k, then the testing data accuracy increases up to a certain point, you know, and after that the accuracy decreases, you know. So my goal is to take, you know, that k value, you know, in which the test accuracy, you know, test accuracy is highest, you know. So that is the way we choose the value of k, otherwise we can directly use k equal to root n. You know, if we take k equal to root n and if we are getting good accuracy, then we can go with that k. Okay, so let's see other question. If data is noisy, no? Noisy means that there are outliers present. No? If my data is noisy, that means that there are outliers present in my data. Okay, so what should we do? That means we increase the value of k or we decrease the value of k. If there are more outliers in my data, yeah, please tell any guesses that what should I do if there are large outliers in my data, then what should I do? Should I increase the value of k or decrease the value of k? Okay, so let's see with one example. Okay, see what will happen. That suppose these are my points, you know, and suppose one this red point is over here, you know, and I want to find the prediction for this point, you know? So as you can see that this red point is an outlier, you know? But if I choose k equal to 1, what will happen? It will see that this is the nearest point. That means, you know, I also belong to this class. You know? In reality, this was an outlier. Now, suppose I change the value of k to 5. You know? So what will it do? It will find the k nearest point. You know, so then blue points will get the majority, you know? So then this will belong to this class, you know? So now it has done the right classification, you know? So now can you tell what should we do? Should we increase the value of k or decrease the value of k if there are outliers in my data? Come on, like I have already explained you. No, by increasing the value of k, I was getting the right class, you know, right classification. You know? So I should increase the value of k if my data is noisy. Okay. And another question is that should the data be normalized for KNN? Should the data be normalized for KNN? Please tell, should the data be normalized? Okay, so like this thing I have already discussed with you earlier, no? So the data should be normalized. Okay? So it's very important. If you don't normalize the data, then my KNN will not work good. Okay, so it's a very important step for both support vector machines also and for KNN also. But for logistic regression, is normalization required or not required? Please tell, for logistic regression, is it required? Is normalization required for logistic regression? Okay, so it is not required, okay, for logistic regression, because we already have a sigmoid function, okay, which changes my output, okay, from 0 to 1. Okay, so that's why we don't need normalization for logistic regression. Okay, so let's see another question. Is KNN a memory based algorithm? is KNN a memory based algorithm? Okay, so the answer is yes, KNN is a memory based algorithm. Why? Because it doesn't build any model, you know, it doesn't build any model from my training data, you know, it just memorizes the data, you know, and whenever a new point comes, you know, then it uses the training data to do the prediction. As simple as that. It doesn't make any model. Okay, so that's why KNN is a memory based algorithm. Okay, so another question is, will the time taken by KNN, you know, to do prediction depend on K? Will it depend on the value of K? Suppose K equal to 1 and K equal to 20. Will the prediction time depend on the value of K? Like, what do you think? Will it depend? The time required for prediction. Okay. So the thing is that it will not depend. You know? So the time required will be same for any value of K. You know? It will be same for any value of K. Because like the steps need to be followed. Okay. Like for every value of K. And you know the steps, what we do. We find the distance, you know, of that new point with every other point, and then we sort those distances, you know. Then we take the points which have the lowest distance from that point, you know. So like that is why, you know. So the main steps, that is sorting, you know, sorting them is taking a lot of time. So that time is constant, you know, if we use any K. Okay, we cannot avoid that sorting. So that is why, okay, it will not depend on the value of K. Now one more question I have. Okay. Yeah. One more question I have. Like, if number of features are more, you know, if number of features are more, you know, and number of samples are less. Number of samples are less. Then which one will perform better? Support vector machines or KNN? Which one will work better? Okay. So SVM will work better. You know? Because I told you, you know, that in case of SVM, that blessing. Blessing of dimensionality is there. So first thing is like blessing of dimensionality is there. So what does it do? Using the kernel trick. Using the kernel trick, it takes the data into higher dimensions so that it becomes linearly separable. So, you know, if the number of dimensions are large, so SVM will be able to perform that, you know. And if the number of samples are less, you know, then also SVM will work better, because it will only depend on the support vectors, you know. It will not depend on the other points. Okay, like we have seen, it will depend on the support vectors only. It doesn't require like, you know, it require these points only. If these points like doesn't exist also, if this one doesn't exist also, then also my model will perform well, you know? Only thing is I need these support vectors. Okay. Like if number of features are more, then KNN, you know, will generally overfit. Okay, so KNN will not be able to do better, you know? So here what will happen, we will use SVM in these cases. Okay, now suppose I reverse the question. I reverse the question. If, you know, number of features are features are less and number of samples are more. If number of samples are more, then which one will perform better, SVM or KNN? So in this case, KNN will perform better. Okay. In this case, KNN will perform better. But what we need to do, we need to find the appropriate value of K. For that, for which the accuracy is highest. C is highest. Okay. So you can see over here that for different kind of data, we tend to use different type of algorithms. Okay, so that's why we are like studying all these different kind of algorithm. Although they are doing the same thing, they are doing classification only, but still we are studying them. Because for we have seen that theorem, no free lunch theorem. Okay, so it says that when one algorithm cannot work well for all the cases. We have to a particular algorithm will work good for particular class of problems. Okay, so that is why we need to study these different type of classification models. Okay, so let's see the last question. Okay, SVM and KNN. Between SVM and KNN, which algorithm is faster? Which algorithm is faster? Okay, so between SVM and KNN, SVM is faster. Now, I'm not able to figure out why it is faster. Maybe you can search it, but this is what I found, that SVM is faster, and why it is faster. First thing is that SVM will build the separating plane. SVM will build the separating plane, after training on the after doing the training, so whenever the test point comes, it will directly see that whether a point is lying on which side, and in whatever side that point will be lying, it will directly tell whether it belongs to class 1 or class 2. But in case of KNN, what will happen? It does the calculation, every time a new point comes, what it will do? It will do the calculation with every point in my training data. Okay, so that's why KNN will take more time for doing the predictions. So that's why we say that SVM is faster. But there would be one other reason also, okay, why SVM is faster. But if you say this thing also in interview, so that will also work, because KNN is a memory based algorithm, and it is not learning anything from the training data. It is just memorizing it, and then it is using that data, for doing the prediction, on the test data that I have. Okay. So, that is the thing. Okay. So, that would be it in this session. So these were the questions I wanted to discuss, and I just wanted to tell you one more thing. Just one more thing. Okay, so I told you that gradient descent we cannot use in SVM. So gradient descent will work for unconstrained problems. But in SVM we use Lagrange multipliers. Multipliers, for finding the separating hyperplane. Okay, so no need to go into the mathematics of this, but just I wanted to tell you the term. Here we use the Lagrange multipliers for optimizing my the problems which have constraints on it. Okay, we will be using Lagrange multiplier. Okay, All right, so like that could be it in this session. Okay. So like, please revise whatever we have studied, whatever theory we have covered. You know, like the thing is that if you will like practice these things, you know, in like, you know, you will build these models, you know, you will program them, then you will understand that like really it works in the same way that I'm telling you. Here too, I have already told you that like here SVM will work better, KNN will work better. But if you will do the practical, then you will get more, much better understanding that which one will work better. You know? So, okay, so that would be it. So my plan is that maybe I will discuss some more case studies with you. Okay, so what you can do that you can use those case studies in your like interviews, you know, like whatever case studies that I have like I'll tell you, like you can use those case studies, okay, in your interviews, like with slight modification. Okay, or other thing what we can do, like you are different people, you know, for different people, you know, we can have different case studies. But like, you know, but the thing is that you can make like small modifications on those case studies, you know, because they will be asking you questions from those case studies, you know, so you should be prepared for every question that can be asked. Okay, so like do prepare some case studies, you know, before going to the interview, so that they will like think that you have done like some practical also. Okay, all right, so like that would be it in this session. Thank you all for participating, and we'll meet tomorrow. Okay, so till then, bye bye everyone.